family, can we put our hands together and welcome those that are joining us online today? So happy to be here. And let me tell you, I am so happy to be in the room with you today. It's been an eventful week for our family. This week, I had the opportunity to take on a speaking engagement that took me out of the state for a couple of days, and I took my entire family with me to Pennsylvania, and we spent a lot of time doing good fall things because the weather up there is great, and the leaves actually change in other parts of the country. It was a really good time, and while we were in Pennsylvania, we decided to take our kids to Gettysburg, Pennsylvania. Now, I have never been to Gettysburg. The only Gettysburg that I knew about was the Gettysburg from the moment in the movie Remember the Titans, when Denzel Washington takes his team there. And so we went to Gettysburg. We thought it'd be a great educational opportunity for our kids. And we went to the Gettysburg National Museum. There's a great museum there. And I'll be honest, my kids range in age. So my youngest is 6, my oldest is 13. So some of them have studied the Civil War. For others, Gettysburg was not about the Civil War. My youngest called it the Cereal War. That's what he thought it was, the Cereal War, a war between Cinnamon Toast Crunch and Fruit Loops or something like that. I don't know. But we took our kids, and it was a really great experience. And I went up to the ticket counter to purchase tickets, and they shared with us that there were a variety of things you could do. You could go see this video that captures the story of what happened at Gettysburg, and you could also do something called a cyclorama. Now, I didn't know what a cyclorama was. I thought it was you ride a bike through Gettysburg. That's not what a cyclorama is. This is a cyclorama. A cyclorama is a way that they used to capture stories back in the 1800s and early 1900s. What you just saw up on that screen was a painting that was 277 feet wide, 42 feet tall, and was 360 degrees, and it captures a particular moment in the war, in the Battle of Gettysburg, called Pickett's Charge. And it was an amazing time to be there, because not only did we get to see this cyclorama, but we got to watch a film, a documentary about the Civil War, narrated by none other than Morgan Freeman, all right? So you know it was really good. What was kind of interesting for me as I was there looking at this moment with my kids is that they were witnessing and remembering an element of history that for many of them was something that has directly affected their life without them even realizing that it has. The last stop that we took was to a place where Abraham Lincoln gave his famous speech, the Gettysburg Address, that begins this way. You guys might know it. Ready? 1, 2, 3, 4, score. Good job. And so I went to that place where he spoke. I think we've got a photo of that as well. And I stood there and I imagined for a moment that I was Abraham Lincoln giving this address that 160 years later, so many of us would know in our own lives. And it got me thinking, how many of those men who fought on that battlefield 160 years ago would know that people from all over the world would come to hear their stories? How many of those men knew exactly what hung in the balance at Gettysburg? Because this was the battle that in many ways determined whether or not the Union Army was going to win or if the South was going to win. There was so much that hung in the balance in these moments. And it got me thinking about legacy. I don't know about you, but whenever I find myself in places like this, historical places, I find myself thinking about legacy. Whether my life is lived for decades to come or it's shorter than I realize, a question I tend to ask, and if you've ever gotten a medical diagnosis before in your life or had a friend that's close to you die sooner than you thought they might, you've probably asked this question: how will I be remembered? What will be written on my tombstone? What stories about me will my kids tell my grandkids when I'm gone? What will be the true worth of my life when it's all said and finished? Now, when I say the word legacy, I want you to ask this question. What comes to mind for you? When I say the word legacy, what comes to mind for you? For you, maybe a legacy is about the story people will share about your life. Maybe a legacy will be the financial resources you leave to the next generation. Perhaps your hope and your dream is that your legacy will be about a business you built or a nonprofit you started or a way that you changed the world. And that question, what is your legacy, is a universal question that all of us at some point in our life will ask. Now, if you're younger in the room, you may not be thinking about it as much right now because you've got a whole lot of life in front of you, at least you think you do. But the older you get, and can I, my older saints, give me a good amen if you agree with this. The older you get, the more you begin to think about legacy. Can I get a good amen if that's true? Yeah? That's good. That's good. And if you're older and you're not thinking about legacy, you're floating down a river called denial. That's what that is, all right? Yeah, we begin to think about legacy. And the question is, what is a good legacy? Because the reality is that if our legacy is focused on how people will remember me or what will people think of me, it may not necessarily be the kind of motivation that's good for us over the long term. So what we're going to look at as we study Paul's letter to the church in Philippi today is how to build an incredible legacy. Well, as we've studied through the book of Philippians, we've looked at these words that Paul has written. It's been marking to me how practical and helpful he is in helping us answer some of life's biggest questions. So over the last couple of weekends, we've talked about how do I build lasting friendships? How do I manage healthy relationships? And today, when we get to Philippians chapter 2, verses 19 to 30, where we'll be, Paul is going to invite us to consider how to live a great legacy. Now, I have to be honest with you, the way that Paul's letter is written in Philippians chapter 2, verse 19 to 30, is very different than how we've been studying up until this point. You see, there's two kinds of passages in the scripture, two kinds of categories. The first category is what we would call prescriptive scripture. A prescriptive scripture is written in such a way where it tells us what to do or how to think or how to act. And the last 3 weeks, we've been looking at prescriptive scripture. Paul says things like, have this mindset, or choose to look over the interests of others more than yourselves. But today's passage is not prescriptive. It's a different kind of text. It's what we call a descriptive text. What Paul is doing here is not telling us how we're supposed to live our lives. What Paul is actually doing is reflecting on and telling the story of a couple of his friends. And this is really, really important, because if you read all of the Bible as if it's prescriptive, you will get yourself in trouble. All right, like a great story in the book of Judges is about this woman named Jehu. She ends up killing a man by taking a tent peg and putting it through his skull because he's an evil leader, okay? That would be a really bad prescriptive text for us to preach, right? Hey, if you don't like a leader, you can murder them. Like, that's not what the point of the text is. I'm around people often who are like, man, I just want to be a part of an Acts 2 church. Anybody ever heard this before? If you're a church person, you heard this before. Acts 2, man, they were sharing everything. They were living together. And it's like, whoa, 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 whoa. Luke was describing how the church was done back then. He's not saying that's how church has to be done now. He was describing something. He wasn't prescribing anything. So the whole argument that we need to live in a commune and share everything, that's descriptive. It's not prescriptive. Are you picking up what I'm putting down? So when we get to this text today, we find ourselves in an interesting place because Paul is not giving us prescriptive language on how to necessarily live. He's just describing two people that are really important to his life. And so instead of giving you a bunch of how-tos today, what we'll find as we reflect on legacy is God is actually inviting us to ask some questions. Some questions I can't answer for you. But only you can answer for you in collaboration with the Holy Spirit. I think today's a good reminder that the Bible was not written to us, but it was written for us. In other words, as Paul sits down to pen this letter to the church in Philippi, he's not necessarily thinking about Nona Church 2,000 years later. He's not necessarily thinking about a world where people can drive cars with batteries. Like, he's not thinking about that world. And yet, there's a ton of wisdom that we can glean when we read the text. So here's what I want to do today. All I want to do is read this text and leave us with one big idea and three questions that I hope you work out in your personal life over lunch and that you carry with you over the next season of your life as you think about what kind of life am I living and what kind of legacy will I leave. Philippians chapter 2, verse 19 to 30, read this way. Paul says, now, I hope in the Lord Jesus to send Timothy to you soon. That's friend number one. To send Timothy to you soon so that I too may be encouraged by news about you. For I have no one else like-minded who will genuinely care about your interests. Everyone else seeks their own interests, not those of Jesus Christ. But you know his proven character, because he has served with me in the gospel ministry like a son with a father. Therefore, I hope to send him as soon as I see how things go with me. I'm confident in the Lord, Paul says, that I myself will come soon. But I considered it necessary to send you Epaphroditus, my brother, my co-worker and fellow soldier, as well as your messenger and minister to my need, since he's been longing for all of you and was distressed because you heard that he was sick. Indeed, he was so sick that he nearly died. However, God had mercy on him, and not only on him, but also on me, so that I would not have sorrow upon sorrow. For this reason, I am very eager to send him so that you may rejoice again when you see him and I may be less anxious. Therefore, welcome him back in the Lord with great joy and hold people like him in high honor, because he came close to death for the work of Christ, making his life to make up what was lacking in your ministry to me. All right, so let's kind of get some framework for what's going on right now. Paul is in a Roman prison, and he's awaiting trial, which will most likely lead to his impending execution. And in a Roman prison, you're allowed to have visitors. And we've got two people that Paul refers to in this text. We've got Timothy, and we've got Epaphroditus. Timothy and Epaphroditus happen to be in Rome at the same time that Paul is in Rome and in prison, and both of these men have been visiting and spending time with Timothy. And Timothy is writing a letter to this church in a place called Philippi. It's a Greek colony somewhere else in the Mediterranean. And he's letting them know, hey, I want you to know how I'm doing, and I want to talk to you a little bit about Timothy and Epaphroditus. Do you understand how this is a descriptive text and not a prescriptive one? It's like in the middle of his letter, as he's given instructions, he gets to this section and he says, hey, I need to remind you about these two guys that you care about, a guy named Timothy and a guy named Epaphroditus. And what we're going to see as we look at the life of Timothy and Epaphroditus today is that we've got two guys that live incredible legacies who didn't know that their names would be canonized in the scripture for all of eternity. Is that not crazy? Like, Timothy and Epaphroditus are not thinking, you know what, based upon the way that I live, I'm going to be included in this letter that's eventually going to meet the canon, and then people across the world are going to read about it and know who we are. Like, that's not happening. They're just everyday guys living everyday lives, a lot like me and a lot like you, right? Now, what I love about Timothy and Epaphroditus is how different they are. So Timothy is Paul's closest friend in confidant. We find this in the text that Paul refers to him as a son in the faith. In your New Testament, you've got 1st and 2nd Timothy, and these are two letters that Paul wrote exclusively for Timothy to read. It's like he's sending him an email, or we have access to his first century DMs between Timothy and Paul. It's amazing to have this kind of access. Some scholars believe that there's even a third letter that we can't find that Paul wrote to Timothy. And Paul and Timothy know each other intensely and closely. In 1st and 2nd Timothy, Paul writes strategy and talks about strategy because Timothy is a multi-site church leader in the city of Ephesus. He's the bishop responsible for all of the churches in this particular Roman city. And Paul's explaining to him how to deal with some of the challenges he's facing in church. So he's a strategy guy. And yet, Paul knows Timothy so intimately that he knows that Timothy struggles with nervousness, anxiousness, and IBS. And so he tells Timothy, due to your IBS, take a little bit of wine because it's going to help you out. Timothy didn't know that that would last for the rest of history. It's like one thing for your friend to know you have IBS. For the whole world, that's a different situation. But that's how close Paul and Timothy are. They've spent years, if not decades, together. Epaphroditus, on the other hand, is not somebody who Paul really knows well. Epaphroditus was a man that lived in Philippi, and when the church in Philippi heard that Paul was in Rome, they collected up an offering, financial gifts, to bring to Paul to basically serve as resources for him so he could get what he needed while he was in prison, and they identified someone to go and be sent on their behalf to take care of Paul, to bring this gift and effectively to serve as Paul's assistant while he was in prison. And Epaphroditus is sent. In a lot of ways, it's like what happens when we send short-term missionaries to go support people that we have a relationship with. They go for a reason and for a purpose. And this is why Epaphroditus goes. Epaphroditus shows up to Rome with money in his pocket to hand to Paul, and his job is to stay there until Paul releases him because Paul might need some help while he is in prison. Paul doesn't know Epaphroditus incredibly well like he knows Timothy, but both of these men, what he writes in their letter, he commends them and says, these men have lived incredible lives and have left good legacies. So when Epaphroditus gets back to Philippi, make sure you treat him with high honor because he has served well. And Timothy, I'm not ready to send him to you just yet because he's my best friend and I don't know what's going to happen with my trial and I'm pretty nervous about what the future might hold and it might be really good for me to have somebody who is my best friend to be with me in the case that things get a little bit harder, a little bit tougher, and a little bit worse for me. So I'm not sending Timothy, but I'm sending you Epaphroditus. If you've got it, say good. Okay. I want to give you that context as we enter into the story because here's what we're going to see. Timothy and Epaphroditus could not be more different guys. And yet, there are three things that are true about their life in this text that raise some good questions for us when we think about the life that we're living and the legacy that we might leave, whether or not we've got 30 years in front of us or 3 minutes in front of us. So if you're taking notes in your Nona Church app or maybe in your formation journal, here's the big idea for today's message. A gospel legacy is made by living intentionally. A gospel legacy is made by living intentionally. So I want to give you 3 intentional questions that you can ask as you really consider what will be the story of my life. What will be said about me when it's all said and done? And the first question is this: what is your why? Write it down. What is your why? In 2011, Simon Sinek, who's an organizational researcher, came out with a book that kind of changed the game. It was a book called Start With Why. In that book, he described why certain organizations do exceptionally well and why other organizations are just kind of okay or mediocre. Like, what's the difference between a company that continues to explode and innovate and create and the dinosaurs that don't make it past kind of the first iteration? What is it that makes certain companies great and other ones okay? And he began to ask that question not just for companies, but for people. What is it that makes certain people great and others just kind of okay? Is it that some have more talent than others? Is it because some have a better education than others? What is the distinction? And what he found was the distinction wasn't necessarily what people knew or necessarily how people did it. It was something deeper. He found that people that quit and organizations that stop and stop thinking, stop innovating, people that like kind of hit a barrier and don't break through it, all have something in common. They live their lives asking 2 questions. What am I doing and how am I going to do it? But the great people, the people whose stories really make the biggest difference, they ask a categorically different question. They ask the question, why? Why am I doing this really? So he calls it the golden circle. I want to explain to you how the golden circle works. You can go ahead and put that up on the screen. The golden circle is connected to this idea that many of us ask the question, what? What am I doing? We ask the question process, how am I going to do it? But the greatest people with the greatest legacies ask the question, why? They have this intrinsic motivation about them that drives everything. And then what we found is that psychologists and neurologists have been able to connect these questions to different parts of the brain. But the question what is connected to our neocortex. It's where we rationally think about our day-to-day. That the how question is connected to our limbic system, our values, how we're going to do something. You guys ever been in a situation before where you got the results you wanted, but you didn't like how you got that result? That's your emotion speaking to you, say, hey, I'm not sure I like how that feels. But there's a deeper question that all of us must ask, and it's connected to our reptitian part of our brain. That's not reptilian, reptitian part of our brain, which is the core element that asks the question, why? It's connected to our identity. It's when we know that we were made to do something in the world. It's not just the work that I do. It's who I am. You ever felt that way before? You ever been around a person like that before? The kind of person who would say, listen, if they didn't pay me any money at all, I would still do this because I love it so much. The person who's just addicted to the process. The person who just loves the ability to think through and continually iterate and process, how can we do this better? See, what I would submit to you today is that the people that know their why and live not from how do I get this done or what needs to be done, but ask the deeper question, why am I doing it really? are the people who experience the greatest joy and satisfaction in life and leave the greatest legacies. I think we see this in the life of Timothy and the life of Epaphroditus. What is clear about both of them is that they both had a clear why. Look at Timothy's why in verses 20 and 21. Paul says this, "For I know of no one who is like-minded like me who will genuinely care about your interests because all seek their own interests." And look what Paul says about Timothy. "Not those of Jesus Christ, but you know his proven character because he has served with me in the gospel and the ministry like a son with a father." In other words, what drives Timothy is his love for Christ. Look at Epaphroditus. In verse 28, when we think about Epaphroditus' life, we see this, that Epaphroditus was indeed so sick that he nearly died, but he did this work for the work of Christ. For both Timothy and Epaphroditus, at the core of their why is the intersection of two things, deep love of God and a deep love for people. It reminds me of the story in Matthew chapter 22, when a lawyer comes to Jesus and he asks him, "Hey, what is the most important law that I can follow? What are the rules that are essential to getting into the kingdom of heaven?" And Jesus looks at him and he says, "Well, you know the answer to that." And he repeats him back to him that you're supposed to love the Lord your God with all your heart. And Jesus says, "Yeah, and love your neighbor as yourself." And then Jesus says, "All of the law," meaning all of the Old Testament, all of that part of the Bible that's sometimes confusing for us, it all hinges upon our ability to love God and to love people. Here's what I want us to hear today. I think that sometimes our hearts can desire a legacy, but that legacy, if it's not connected at its core to wanting to do what loves God the most and loves people the most, will end up creating in us a lackluster life. To quote St. Augustine of Hippo, "O Lord, you have made us for yourself, and our hearts are restless until they find their rest in you." Look here. If your legacy and your drive in life is to have enough money to be able to retire, that's a fine desire, but you're going to find yourself empty at the end. If your desire is to have a good family with good kids, it's not a bad desire. It's just not what you were made for. If your desire is to change the world for good, anybody want to do that? Just want to change the world for good, right? And that's what your ultimate desire is. It's not a bad desire. It's just less than what you were made for. St. Augustine of Hippo puts it so well. You were made for God. And if you stop at what can I do to change the world, or how can I do it to change the world, or what can I do to retire, and how can I get there faster, or what can I do so people will remember me, and how can I make sure that everybody does remember who I am, those are good desires. They're not ultimate ones, though, because you're not asking the core and most important question. Why am I doing this really? And if the answer to that question is not love of God, you are letting go of what you've been made to do. You ever been in a situation where you realize that something that you have is, you're using it in a way that it wasn't actually made to be used? So I appreciate the Apple Store. Sometimes I just walk in there just to walk around and see how busy it is and think, how much money does this company make really? Like, it's just amazing to me, right? But one of the things I do appreciate about the Apple Store is that people there that work there, they're not paid on commission. So when you go in to purchase something, they don't actually get any benefit from upselling you, which is somewhat helpful, right, to know that. Because anybody else like me, you're not an expert in technological things, and so sometimes you're like, do I need this really? So I recently went in to get a laptop and was talking with the gentleman there, incredibly kind. And I was explaining to him the things that I do on a laptop. And he's like, so tell me, what do you do? Do you kind of take photos? I was like, bad ones on my phone. he's like, do you edit movies? No, I don't do that either. Do you play video games? I was like, I'm a dad with four kids. No, I don't do that. I don't play video games. He's like, okay. Do you know that that's a profession now? And I'm like, that's amazing. Like, can you imagine your kid saying, Dad, when I grow up, I want to be a professional video game player? Like, people make money doing that now, right? Like, that's a thing you can do. I was like, this is wild. I was like, well, I think that this is the computer that I want. And he said, well, what do you do? I was like, well, I write sermons. I have a big library of, like, commentaries. And I write a lot. Like, he's like, word processing? I was like, yeah. He's like, oh, you don't need that computer. That computer is designed for, like, creative people who do really creative things and need a lot of processing power. He's like, let's leave this area and let's bring you over here. Because this wasn't made for that. Lean in for a minute. You weren't made for that. You weren't made for the lesser life of simply thinking about how can I retire and make my kids nice and make sure that, like, my marriage stays together. You were made for God. You were made to be so closely connected to Him, intertwined with His Spirit, hearing His voice so clearly that when you step, you know you're stepping because He stepped. When you're moving, you know you're moving because He's moved. Do not allow your life to slip into the simplicity of saying, well, good is good enough when you've been made for God. So here's the question I would ask you. Especially in a community like ours, when we can get distracted by the next zip code, the next upgrade, the next nice thing, the next promotion, the next opportunity, the next build, the next thing for our kid, I want you to ask this question deeply. What is it that you're doing? How is it that you're doing it? And why are you doing it really? Here's the question. As you look at what you do and how you do it, is it really marked by a deep love for God and for others? Because if it's about you, that's a really terrible why. Because you were made for more than that. So the first question that we see that the text raises up inside of us is, what's your why? Here's the second one. How is your character? What's your why? How is your character? Another interesting dynamic I see in the lives of Timothy and Epaphroditus is the way that Paul speaks about their character. Paul literally says in verse 21 that Timothy has proven character. And then he calls Epaphroditus in verse 25 a brother, a co-worker, and a fellow soldier. Like, isn't that like a pretty great set of compliments to be given by the guy who wrote half of the New Testament, right? Paul's like, hey, he's my brother. He's my coworker. I'd go to work with him. But even more importantly, I would go to war with him. That's how much I trust him. It's been said that our character is who we are when no one else is looking. And I think Pete Scazzaro has this great way of describing this in his book, Emotionally Healthy Spirituality, where he talks about our life like an iceberg. And so I want you to see this image as well. This is what an iceberg tends to look like. You may know this already, but the majority of an iceberg is not what you see above water, it's what you see underwater. And what Scazzaro likes to talk about is the reality that for many of us, we live our life thinking about our outer life. This is what people see. This is how kind I am when I'm in public. This is how I relate to somebody when I buy something and they flip the thing over and ask me to leave a tip. Anybody kind of, you know what I'm talking about, right? You have this moment where you're like, oh my gosh, if I don't leave a tip, what does that say about me? What are they going to think about me? What percentage am I willing to give right now in such a way that allows me to feel better about myself? And some of you guys are like, I've already settled that. I don't leave a tip. If you've done nothing for me, I'm not going to leave you a tip. That's awesome. Just don't have a Nona Church polo on when you're doing that, all right? Our outer life is how people perceive us. And what Scazzaro talks about is that the majority of the work in our life, our character, is our inner life. It's what people don't see that is most important. It's who I am when no one else is looking. See, Timothy and Epaphroditus are very different people. One is a bishop who oversees a multi-site movement of churches in the city. The other is a messenger and a personal assistant at best. One traveled with Paul and preached with him on his behalf. The other is an errand runner who's been entrusted with a daily to-do list from Paul. And yet, both of these men have incredible legacies, listen to me, not because of what they did or accomplished, but because of who they were. The lie we can sometimes believe is that I have to do something big or important for God, or I have to make my mark in order to leave a legacy. But what God measures is oftentimes different than what the world measures. We live in a world that seems to think that character is an afterthought, but in the kingdom of God, it's actually considered more valuable than talent. The wisdom writer puts it this way about women in Proverbs 31. He says, a wife of noble character, who can find? She is worth far more than rubies. Proverbs 18 verse 6 says, better to be lowly in spirit along with the oppressed than to share plunder with the good. Now hear me, character is not trying to get everyone to like you or to think highly of you, because we know that both Jesus and Paul didn't have that experience. And many people we celebrate today were hated in their time here on the planet. Did you know Martin Luther King Jr.'s unfavorable rating was 63% in 1966? Like on a scale of -5 to +5, 40% of people marked him as -5. They thought that he was a disease to humanity. It reminds me that character isn't something that the public always recognizes, but it's more so an internal constitution that you know that you are doing what is right and what is good regardless of public opinion. And we become people of high character when, in the words of Pastor John, who you'll hear from next Sunday, we have nothing to gain, nothing to prove, and nothing to hide. Character is the decision to do what honors God wherever he has you, regardless of the cost to you or if anyone sees it. So let me paint a picture for you, and I want you to internally decide what you would do in this situation. We're flying back from Pennsylvania. We're in the Philadelphia airport, and our flight gets delayed, so we actually go to do another event with our kids. We take them to a corn maze. We do a lot of fun things that we would never do in Florida. And so our flight's pushed back, and because Stacy and I travel a lot, we've got TSA PreCheck, and so we usually just use PreCheck to get through with our kids, and it kind of shortens the amount of time that we need to be there. So we get to the Philadelphia airport. We go to check in. We do everything that we're supposed to do. We're headed towards the TSA PreCheck line. It is a 4-minute wait in the TSA PreCheck line. It is a 36-minute wait in the regular people line. It is a 36-minute wait in the other line. And we come in with our kids. Now, the woman at the TSA PreCheck counter goes through our boarding passes, and she asks me the age of our kids. Now, if your child is 12 years old, they can travel with you if you're with PreCheck. If your child is older than 12 and they are not passed through by PreCheck, you may not travel with them. We are most likely going to miss our flight because of how close we've cut it as we're in the PreCheck line, and I have a 13-year-old. Now, I want you to ask yourself this question. When the TSA agent asks you, how old are your children, what would you say? I said, gosh, you guys really think I said 12? I didn't say 12. I said 13, 11, 7, and 6. And the woman looked at me and she said, well, you can't use PreCheck then. You need to go out of this line and go to the back of the other line. And can I tell you that everything inside of me in that moment was like, this is ridiculous. I'm doing the right thing, and you are still punishing me anyway. You guys ever felt that way before? See, we live in a culture that thinks it's kind of fine to say 12. We live in a culture that says it's kind of okay to cut a corner. It's kind of okay to do what needs to be done because the result is really more important than how you get there. But Reggie Joyner has this really, really great line. He's a parenting expert, and he says this: what I give to my children or what I do for my children is not as important as what I leave in them. And what does it teach a child when a parent says 12 instead of 13? What does it teach them about what character is and what right is and what wrong is. And see, every single day, you and I have decisions to make about the kind of legacy we're going to leave. Because although I said here that character is the decision to do what honors God wherever he has you, regardless of the cost to you, or if anyone sees it, the bottom line is people see it. If you're a parent, they're paying attention. If you're a leader, they're paying attention. If you're a boss, they're paying attention. And how what we do matters. Three things to note about character that I want to give you quickly, especially if you're going to invite someone into your life. I want to give you three things quickly out of this text. And this is to help you, especially if you're thinking about like a boyfriend to date, right? Or a person to break up with. If you're thinking about a company to go work for, if you're thinking about a community to get involved in, here are the three things that I think are true about character that we see from the text. The first one is this: strength of character is usually observed over time. Verse 22, Paul says, "You know of his proven character because he has served with me." Paul knows about Timothy because he's been with Timothy for a long time. The second one is this: strength of character is usually observed up close. Like a son with the father, says Paul about Timothy. He's like, I know him that much. And strength of character is usually seen through hardship. In verse 28 and 29, we see this. Even when it would have been easier for Epaphroditus, who was sick, to quit because he was about to die, he stayed faithful to complete his mission and minister to Paul. Hear me. Character is not tested in hard seasons. It is revealed. So here's the question. How's your character? How's your character? Is who you are below the surface more substantial than who you are above it? And hear me, character isn't a destination that we arrive at. It's a journey we pursue. For me, one way that I try to ensure that my character is solid is that every year I give a survey to people who have known me over time and who have observed me up close to give me constructive criticism. I literally send an email to people with a series of questions asking them to assess my character and ask them to be as honest as possible about how they feel about me. Do you think I enjoy reading the emails when it's all said and done? It's a nerve-wracking moment every time I get the responses back. But the reason why I do this is because I want over time for who I am underneath the water to always be stronger and more formidable than who I am above it. And maybe that's a good question for you to ask. When was the last time people around you had an opportunity to communicate to you about how they're experiencing you? Because character is not something that happens and develops accidentally. It's something that happens through intention. So here are a couple questions to ask. What's it like to be on the other side of me? Where do you have concerns about my character? What do you hope mentors and colleagues are telling me? Let me ask you this. Do you have a plan to assess your character? Because character isn't something that accidentally improves. It happens by intention. So, another thing we learn from the text, we ask the questions, what is your why? How's my character? And lastly, what will you risk? I want you very quickly to think about the things you enjoy in life. Think about the car you drive. Think about the phone that's in your hand, the house you own or rent, the job that you have, the church you're a part of, the building you're sitting in right now, the campus that we've opened up at Narcoosee. Here's what all of these things have in common. Every single thing that has been a blessing to you, here's what they have in common. Someone had to risk for them to happen. Someone had a vision of starting something new, to solve a problem or to make a difference, and they risked something along the way. Here's how I would put it. The fruit of blessing grows from the root of risk. And for Timothy and for Epaphroditus, both had a lot to risk. Paul points to Epaphroditus and says that he risked his life to fulfill his ministry. Epaphroditus literally risks his very life for the sake of serving Paul. And while it's not explicit in this text with Timothy, we know that Timothy's work with Paul over the years has led him to risk his life as they planted churches. And while they're in Rome, both Timothy and Epaphroditus are risking a lot by even being associated with Paul. Like last time I checked, it's not really good to be known as the guy who's advocating for, sharing life with, and doing as much as you can for the guy that's in prison. That puts you on a Roman watch list. Can we agree? There's a lot that Timothy and Epaphroditus are willing to risk. And the reason why is because they saw their ministry to Paul as a call from Christ. A call from Christ. And here's what I know. There will be moments in your life where the gravitational pull of an earthly legacy, fat retirement account, a name on a building, an award from the company, will seem like it's enough, but you were made for so much more. You were made for a life that would be poured out for a cause so eternal, a mission so essential, and a God so beautiful. Because God is not interested in being number one on your list of priorities. He is interested in being the priority upon which everything else that happens in your life finds itself a place in. C.S. Lewis has this great line. He says, aim at heaven and you will get earth thrown in. Aim at earth and you will get neither. And I think this is the failure of many of us in our culture today. Reminds me of the story of the young rich ruler in Matthew 19. In the story, he comes to Jesus and he says, what do I have to do to follow you? And Jesus says, sell everything that you have and come and follow me. And the text tells us that he walks away sad and disappointed because he was not willing to let go of what was in his hand to reach out to get what was even better. He was unwilling to let go of what he could not keep to gain what he could not lose. And I read that story often, and the question that I ask myself is, what would I have done? Like if the Lord came to me and said, Collin, give up your mortgage, give up your house, give up your family, give up your comfort, give up your 401k, give up your retirement account, give up your investments because I'm inviting you to risk it all for my sake. Would I be willing to do it? And the question is, would you? Would you? Or have we begun to believe the lie that what God came to do and purchase for us was ease on earth so we could eventually get to heaven? Or did God come to die on our behalf so that every aspect of our life would be turned over to him, where we would say, God, whatever you want, whenever you want, however you want to do it, I'm here because you're that good. And if the answer for us is no, I want you to know you don't have to feel shame about that. It's just an indicator that we all have room to grow and really believing that God is that good. Like the good news of the gospel is that God is actually worthy of us risking everything because he's promised that even if we lose everything here on earth, we'll get him. And the deep question we all must ask is, do I really want him? Paul puts it this way in Philippians chapter 3. We'll see this verse next week, where he says, yes, everything else is worthless when compared with the infinite value of knowing Jesus. For his sake, I have discarded everything else, counting it all as garbage so that I could gain Christ. That is in stark contrast to what Jesus says in Mark 8 when he says, what does it profit a man to gain the whole world but lose his soul? Our lives will be marked by one of two legacies. We saw Christ as the prize and lived with every ounce of our heart driven toward desiring him, or we settled for less than what we were made for because it was easier and less costly. So here's the question. What sacrifices are you willing to make and risks are you willing to take for the cause of Christ? Like maybe there is a nonprofit inside of you that someone else is waiting for you to start because God's placed it in you, but it'll take risk. Maybe what's inside of you is a church that needs to be started for the sake of the city. Are you willing to take the risk? What if what's inside of you is the need to go first in a relationship where pride has created a barrier of connection and neither person is willing to forgive the other to come in humility and the cost is the very soul of the person on the other side? Like we all have to make this decision, don't we? Will my life be marked by nice, shiny things, a perceived sense of success, and God on the side? Or will my life be marked by God, it's all yours. And whatever you give me, I'm willing to give it away if you tell me to. Can I just talk to the parents for a minute and grandparents? Will the story that our kids hear about God I feel this in my own life. Will the story that my kids grow up hearing about God be, God saved me, I'm a good person, and I help some people? Or will the story our kids grow up seeing is, mom and dad believed that Jesus was so good and so worthy and so valuable that they were willing to risk anything, go anywhere, because he mattered that much? You get to decide that. What will your legacy be? With that in mind, I want to invite you to stand today as we close out our time. And as we respond today, I want to ask you this question. Maybe you could close your eyes. And as we do here at Nona, a way to invite you to respond is by opening your hand. I'm going to ask you three questions. And as you hear the question that you're like, hey, I need to work through this one, would you just open your hand and say, yeah, Lord, I know that you're talking to me about this. So with your eyes closed, as we respond today, here's what I would want to ask you. Where is God inviting you to reconsider how you think about your legacy? For some of us, we need to rethink our why. And we need to reevaluate our motives. If that's you, would you open your hand? If you're like, I'm not living for a compelling why, it's a what or how to me. Would you just open your hand? Like, is it about God really? Is it about him really? For others of us, here's the question. We need to be honest about our character. Like, who we are above the surface is way nicer than who we are underneath it. For some of us, we need to repent. For others, we need to get help. If that's you today, would you have the courage of opening your hands and say, yeah, God, I know that's me. I know that's me. And for others, it's time to risk. Like, we have been playing this season of our life not to lose, instead of playing the season of our life with a desire to win for the sake of the gospel, for the sake of Christ. For some of you, it is time to give of yourself. It is the time to serve others. It is time to step out. If that's you, would you open your hands now too? Here's what's true for all of us. We might need reminding of the gospel. Because of Jesus, even if our name is forgotten here on earth, our name is nothing more than forgotten on a tombstone 3 generations from now. If no one ever writes a letter and includes us in it, I have good news for you, that your name is forever written in the book of life, because your legacy is Christ. And every single thing you do on God's behalf, he sees, he names, and he acknowledges. But here's my hope. For those of us that are older in the room thinking about legacy, it's not too late. And for those of us that are younger in the room, my hope is that you would be captured by a why so much greater than the American dream, that your life would be spent doing things that really make a difference in the world, things that you were made and placed on this planet to do.